to the Global Economic Outlook session, which I'm very delighted to moderate this very, very interesting juncture in the world economy. Before I set up the issues, let me introduce briefly this distinguished panel, since I'm sure you know all the speakers.
欢迎大家参加全球经济转换论坛。那么在全球经济发展到这个时候，我来主持这个，我来主持这个论坛是属于荣幸。那么接下来在开展讨论之前呢，请允许我向大家介绍一下在座的座谈嘉宾。
The first speaker is Christine Lagarde, the managing director of the IMF, and it appears very likely to continue to be the managing director of the IMF again.
这位坐在我最左手方的嘉宾是 IMF 总裁克里斯蒂娜·拉贾德，并且非常有希望连任其总裁职位。
And the second speaker, for several more years, partly because of the enthusiasm of people like him, George Osborne, the Chancellor of Exchequer and First Secretary of State of the United Kingdom. And of course, he has been nominated for another term.
在我右手边的这位是英国财相乔治·奥斯本，他也被提名来连任下一任财相。
And the third speaker is Haruhiko Kuroda, the governor of the Bank of Japan, and the woman engaged in the one of the most important and interesting monetary experiment of all time.
第三位嘉宾呢是来自日本银行的行长黑田东彦，他是参与到了非常有意义也非常有意思的一次货币试验当中。
And our last speaker is Tijen Tian, who is the chief executive officer of Credit Suisse AG.
最后一位嘉宾是瑞士信贷集团总裁谭天中先生。
As you have all surely noticed, in the last months, we had a mass amount of market turbulence in exchange markets and in stock markets. The S&P has down to 1900. And for oil, I just look up at my paper this morning. West Texas Intermediate is 31.61, still incredibly low. That's a very significant price adjustment. And bond yields, US 10 years, 2.06, German 10 years, 0.49, and Japanese 10 years, 0.24, which is really staggering. The IMF, looking at the economy, has produced its recently forecast, and it expects that this year growth to be higher than last year, 3.4% against 3.1%.
那么在上个月当中呢，我们无论是在外汇市场还是在股票市场中都遭遇了颠簸，标准普尔指数下跌到900点，而西德克萨斯中间级原油指数跌至31.61，而十年期的美国债券。
concern about a number of financial risks, corporate the debt in emerging markets, and of course, debt overhanging in developed markets and economies remain very, very large in many countries, private and of course, public.
世界经济正在一个调整期当中，我们看到大宗商品价格对于国家或者是公司都造成了很大的影响。在这一过程中，有像巴西和俄罗斯这样的受害者，但是也有人从中受益，像是中国、印度或是大部分的欧洲国家。当中我们也看到了挑战，其中之一就是美国的经济下滑，也在此环境下，美联储收紧其利率。同样，我们还面临发展中国家以及发达国家当中的债务问题。
But we do solve some problems.This year, nobody is obsessed with the possibility. I believe the Eurozone is about to fall apart. So nobody is obsessed with this possibility. And not much discussion of Brexit. But instead, we now talk about Brexit. So we will have a discussion in that. And Brexit is just one of a number of examples of major political risks.Or political-driven risk, which has economical consequences, and the migration crisis in Europe. The fascinating, in terms of some people, certainly including me, terrifying possibilities in U.S. presidential election. The rise of populism everywhere and international relation issues in the Middle East between Russia and Europe remain very, very significant.So these are very turbulent and fascinating times. So in view of this, I've decided we are going to start with the view of what is going on in the market and how significant it is for the economy, how worried we should be. So I'm going to start with Tijian Tian and ask her for her brief reactions of what on earth is going on.From the perspective of someone who's actually having to manage it and survive it day by day.
那我们在这边其实知道，在欧，英国是脱离了欧洲，但事实上大家没有很纠结于这个问题。但是在这里，我们这个问题是要讨论的。在这个问题呢，其实是众多的政治风险，或者是由政治问题导致的风险。这些风险呢，影响到了经济层面上的运行，也造成了移民上的问题上的危机。那么，其实我和大家一样，对于美国总统大选是很担忧的。同时，在中东、俄罗斯以及欧盟这样的地区，也出现民粹主义抬头的这种趋势。总而言之，我们处在一个动荡的年代。那么，这对于市场意味着什么呢？这样的影响又有多大？在我们应该对这样的情况抱以怎样的心情，或者说应该为此担忧呢？接下来请谭中天先生来为我们简要的说一下他对于这种环境下的应对。
Okay, thank you, Martin. So what on earth is going on? Simply the worst year, financial year ever that on the record, simple ever. So if you look at the numbers, it is the worst start we have 3 months in a year. So what's driving that?Maybe I can tell a few words about what the market believes and then a few words about what we believe.
谢谢马丁。现在我给大家说一下这个世界到底发生了什么。我可以说今年是有史以来财政史上是最差的一年。通过数字我们也可以发现今年的发展的确很不乐观。我下面将会说一下市场 相信这个世界发生了什么，以及我相信这个世界发生了什么。
The market is very worried about China, and of course the growth in China. We see a 6.9 growth in China coming up. Two issues: they have in markets that doesn't necessarily believe the number 6.9, and also they believe that there will be a hard landing in China, or a very significant decrease in the growth of China.
市场认为中国在未来6.9%的增长是不太可行的。他们也认为，中国的经济将持续下滑，会有硬着陆的现象发生。
But there are direct implications on food commodities, oil, and growth in other parts of the world. So with the fear that we might, step into a global recession, and also a lot of fears around that the oil sector itself, which for the shale gas operator is highly deleveraged, we have seen the high debt we have priced brutally.
大宗商品和石油价格的下跌，以及全世界正处于一个很萧条的一个阶段，我们也担心的是因为石油价格下跌而导致页岩气的低杠杆化。以及我们现在所处的高债额的收益。
And at the beginning of the Europe and at the end of the 15, also triggering growth in portfolio. In the background that, there is a really important technical factor that sees massive redemption, massive outflows from the asset management. As I mentioned before, some of them are driven by the sovereign wealth funds. So you have a lot of distressed sales in the market, which is also weighing on the market levels.
欧洲的经济有这几个因素，一个就是，大量的资本的一个回流，是归因于主权财富基金和亏本销售。
Now quickly look at what we believe. What we believe, we actually believe that China will have a soft landing.We are not concerned about Chinese growth. The old argument is all about that it is a demand issue or it is a supply issue. And a lot of people believe that the demand in China is decreasing and pronounced a slowdown of increase in China.
下面我将说一下我们认为发生了什么。我们认为中国是软着陆，我们并不担心中国增长。有些人会说而实际上这是一个供需的一个问题，但他们认为中国的需求正在下跌。
We actually don't agree with that, but the net demand for oil has increased in 15, something like 1.2 billion barrels per day, and before that, the number is just half of that in China. So actually, the demand in China has increased, so it's a supply problem.
我们不同意这个说法，因为石油的需求是在增长的，是15%，大约有12亿桶每天的产油量，有1/2都是需求是来自于中国，所以我们认为中国的需求是在增加，只是供给的问题。
So that is the good news for the overall economy. We also believe that the low oil prices are good for the world economy.Good for the U.S. consumer, good for the Europe, and good for over 5 billion people all around the planet, who are basically net importers or net consumers of oil. The consumer's huge potential purchasing power is good for all.
我认为，对于全世界的经济来说，这是一个好消息。油价的下跌对于全球、对于美国的消费者、对于欧洲以及对于地球上的50亿人来说，都是一个很好的消息，因为。这些人都是进的出口以及主导的消费力，所以消费主力是很重要的。
Thank you very much for that very clear statement for where you think we are. So, Christian Lagarde, in light of that, how We see global growth in 2016 as being modest and even, and with 4 downside risks, but it's up. You know, we tend to forget that, as you said, Martin, from 3 in 2015, and we see that 3.4 in 2016 and 3.6 in 2017. So the fact is that we actually increased the global value of our economies.
谢谢马丁，早上好。2016年全球的经济是的发展很不平衡，是中速，但是发展很不平衡，有四个下行的风险。2015年的全球增长是 3%， 2016年是 3.4%， 2017年是 3.6%， 但是我们认为总体的增长趋势向好。
Now let me focus on the four downside risks that we see on the horizon. One is what I called the triple transition of the Chinese economy, and by triple transition, I mean moving from industry to service, from export to domestic market, and from the investment to consumption. That's the triple transition that is going through.
下面我将主要说一下四个下行的风险。我认为中国现在经历的一个三重的转型期，首先是从工业化向服务业转型，其次是从出口为导向转向以市场为中心的转型，第三个则是由投资型转向消费型。
Well, it's a massive undertaking and it's one where we forecasted China to be 6.8 in 2015, and they are 6.9. So for those who pretend that they are very surprised about it, we're certainly outwards expected. And we hope that Chinese authorities will recognize the efforts that it takes to conduct those three transitions that they are determined to conduct, and that it will have an impact on the growth rate, and it will slow it down, which will be a great way to actually facilitate the transition and lower that first downside risk.
对于中国来说，这是一个巨大的工程。我们预计2015年中国增速为 6.8%， 但实际上增速为 6.9%， 这是很多人都感到很吃惊，没有意料到的。中国对这三个转型期也认识到要付出很多的努力，以及肩负很重大的责任。这个转型期对于增长率以及对于中国的转型都有着很大的影响，并且也会从某种程度上降低我之前所说的第一个下行风险。
The second downside risk is commodity prices, which have trended lower for the last 5 years.But where the lowering of the prices have been accelerated, certainly as a perception of it, has been accelerated in the last year and a half as a result of oil prices, which probably slightly going to improve as demand seems to improve a little bit over the course of the last few months. To be seen, but is still regarded as a downside risk.
大宗商品价格的下跌在过去五年间都很不稳定，但是油价会持续上升，因为基于我们需求的上升，所以这是我所说的第二个风险。
And the third one is asynchronous monetary policies conducted around the world, which entail quite a lot of flow of capitals from emerging and low-income countries to advanced countries.Particularly for the U.S. and which entail combined with the lower commodity prices, a significant exchange rate impact by way of depreciation on some of the emerging market economies.
第三个下行风险主要是货币政策，全球都在实施同一个货币政策，新兴经济体以及低收入的经济体，他们 的现金流正在流向发达国家，比如说美国。
Just a quick word on those emerging market economies, if I may, Martin. They are different. We used to talk about the BRICS. I think it's not a fallacy, but the economic performance is vastly different. If you look at India, which is increasing at, I think, 7.5%, and seem to be thriving, which is conducting some difficult reforms. And China, which is greatly slowing down in hopefully a controlled way with financial markets, by the way, which are extremely minute relative to the size of the overall Chinese economy. Russia and Brazil, which for different reasons are going to be in negative territory yet again this year.
下面我说一下新兴经济体的发展状况，他们